Mark Victor Hansen has changed the world, one story at a time. Mark first gained international recognition and praise as one of the co-founding authors of the beloved and world record-breaking best-selling book series, Chicken Soup for the Soul. In addition to being hailed as one of the world's most wonderful speakers, Mark is an entrepreneur with a proven track record. He's built numerous successful businesses and is also co-creator of the groundbreaking wealth-generating book series, The 1 Minute Millionaire. Mark is America's ambassador of possibility. His wisdom is as good as gold. Made for Success is proud to present Mark Victor Hansen.
Hi, I'm Mark Victor Hansen, and welcome. We're going to talk about rip-roaring innovation. And rip-roaring innovation is what makes the economy move for you and for everyone. So listen close. Two ways money is made. One is innovation, and the other is marketing. And now we're going to talk about innovation. Let's start by quoting maybe the smartest man that America's ever had, Dr. Albert Einstein, and he said, "Highly developed spirits often encounter resistance from mediocre minds." Think about that. An innovation is something that changes everything. The term is often applied to people known as innovators. What a strange and wonderful group they are. They find their homes far from the acceptable suburbs of thought where the common mind survives. The true beauty in an innovative mind is that it harbors expertise on the future. They sense change long before anyone else does, and they don't care what others think about them or their work. Those who are willing, even in the face of certain death, to defend what they believe in, did so because they knew it was the only way. Innovators are usually ostracized and given labels such as crazy, rebellious, useless, fake, and every other offensive term. Do you think that the Wright brothers cared that people call them crazy? Do you think that Picasso was concerned with what his critics had to say about him and his art? Of course they didn't, because they knew beyond any doubt that their ideas were the future, and they were willing to do whatever it took to destroy the limitations which formed the current mold of acceptance. It is not unusual to be called crazy when you have an idea that can change everything. Experts are often wrong about whether or not something will succeed because they focus on the past rather than future possibilities. My book series, Chicken Soup for the Soul, was turned down by 144 publishers because not one of them could see the potential of this new, untried area publishing had to offer. Today, Chicken Soup for the Soul is my worldwide brand with renowned respect throughout the publishing industry and is also recognized for changing the game of stories. Without innovation, the world cannot grow. How can you choose to do something new if nothing new is there for you to choose? Someone must always be creating, despite what current societal climate dictates. There's a possibility everywhere. And the only way to find it is to look at things differently. Most innovators are rejected because they think in a way which is far different from the norm. Innovators do not think in a box, because most of them don't even know what a box is. In order to move forward, you must let go of the past. You must be fearless, willing to take risks to get you where you need to be. Profiles of Genius by Gene Landrum boldly acknowledges, quote, "The ability to bet the farm on one's belief is fundamental to successful entrepreneurship," end of quote. Entrepreneurs are pavers of destiny's road. They consistently prove to us that the smartest typically make the most impact. Landrum cites Dr. Ilya, the 1977 Nobel Prize winner, who proved that the more complex the system, the greater the instability. Don't worry that you're the only one person. This is where the advantage lies. Experts are the leading cause to the extinction of innovation and innovators. The reason that innovators face such severe resistance from experts is because their innovation is often a direct threat to the expertise and credibility. When the accepted standard changes, it affects a lot of people, especially if those people have a personal investment, such as time at school, financial investments in company with old technology, or whatever the case may be. There's very little tolerance for people who have a solution to a problem that fuels many industries. People are stuck in the past, can't see all the new and wonderful industry that will arise as a direct result of a game-changing discovery. The outdated methods always benefit those who are making money from them, and they don't want that to change. What you're going to learn from these naysayers is that the life giver of your innovation is your own belief in your ideas. Where does innovation come from? Innovation arises from the insatiable passion to take into action the things that you love despite the judgment of others. It arises from the insatiable desire to avoid settling. Things are never the way they should be for an innovator because they're constantly asking, why not? Why not send a man to the moon? Why not transmit images on a radio-like device? Why not? You need to ask, why not? Whatever it is that you want to see done that hasn't been innovated yet. The next time you are challenged or you come into contact with an impossible feat, ask yourself, why not? Don't focus on why you can't. Instead, refuse to settle until you have found a way to accomplish it. In fact, remove the word can't from your vocabulary altogether. When Henry Ford of Ford Motor Company wanted to put together a V8 engine, he told his engineers, I want it, I demand it, and I'll have it. And it seemed impossible to them, and it came back to him every 6 months and said, it's impossible, Mr. Ford. His reply was, I don't care, make it happen or get a job elsewhere. Somebody's going to figure this out with me. This is how innovators act. Andrew Carnegie once shared his wisdom. All riches and material things that anyone wants to acquire begin in a clear, concise mental picture of the things one seeks. I say you're attracted to the physical equivalent of your mental picture that is your driving intention. If you have an intense burning desire, with the aid of others, any achievement is possible. The value of two or more minds working together with vision, courage, the spirit of cooperative harmony, initiative, and a big plan makes you and them and your creation unstoppable. Innovators must have a clear vision of what they want to accomplish. If an innovator does not, it is very easy to get shut down, discouraged, and misled. As with anything in life, you must know what you want before you can get it. Here's a little homework assignment for you. The next time you encounter a problem, look at it through the eyes of an innovator that you admire. Pretend you have a magic pair of glasses, and when you put them on, you begin to see the world through the eyes of that person. If Oprah is the one you admire, you'd be looking at your problem with Oprah vision. You would make a decision like Oprah would. Perhaps you admire the courage of James Bond. Use your Bond vision to solve your problem. You could adapt Ford vision and just do it anyway. Let great innovative personas inspire you up the depth of your being. There's no limitation to possibility until you put it there. Do you want to limit your possibility? No. Repeat after me, my possibilities are unlimited. This is a mantra you want to repeat throughout the day and throughout the rest of your life. Just keep reiterating to yourself, my possibilities are unlimited. And as you do, you're going to get the shackles of limitation taken away from your eyes, your mind, your heart, and your soul. The impossible is only identified and created when you label it as such. Great things come from great challenges. Diamonds are created by immense amounts of pressure, resulting in their extraordinary and extreme value. If there's something that you know will be a diamond, follow your heart. You must risk to be rewarded. The ability to accept risk is integral to innovation. There's never been reward without risk, and there never will be. Without risk, there's no consequences, either good or bad. Marcel Bick, creator of Bic, the company that creates disposable pins, razors, and lighters, was told by the experts there was no market for his products. Were they wrong? Yes, they absolutely were. Bic's personal philosophy was, concentrate on one product used by everyone every day. Build them strong and sell them cheap. Bick, like many other innovators, was turned down by the leading experts and was repeatedly told there was no market and that he didn't understand the subtle nuances of the sophisticated world of distribution. It is important to make a distinction here about innovation and invention. The most difficult task of innovation is simplification. When you're able to simplify a complex topic into easily understood and elegant explanation or product, you have touched upon true genius. When you can reduce something to its simplest state, where only the pure and unhindered soul of that thing remains, that is when you will be capable of deciding what that thing is and its meaning. Until you reveal the soul of what you are trying to accomplish, it remains lifeless. When you arrive at that point, it will resonate in your soul. Always ask yourself, why? Why is it like this? How can I make it better? If you start to do this, your perspective will begin to change. Possibilities will reveal themselves to you. Possibilities that you are never present enough to see before. Innovation demands that we are continually observant. Tom Kelly wrote in his great book, The 10 Faces of Innovation, every company has a devil's advocate who raises questions and concerns without taking any personal responsibility. They are the most potent innovation killers on the planet. Kelly, who is a friend and has done a lot of meetings with me, also advises that an anthropologist may be on your team. Now, an anthropologist goes out into the field to assess how a customer is going to use and respond to a product. If you're going to be an innovator, you must be able to effectively counter the naysayers, and there's no better way to do that than test and prove your product. This is what we did with Chicken Soup for the Teenage Soul. We tested on 12,000 kids at Nickelodeon. They loved it, they wanted it, they rated it, and we picked the number one story. It was a 10++++. That was our anthropological innovation test. This works again and again. We did it on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best. The results were fascinating. The highest rated story by the children was a story about how to handle abuse, while the results for adults were exactly opposite. We used the information to silence a naysaying publisher who said, kids will never buy that. I have teenagers and they buy CDs, concert tickets, and clothes. They're not going to buy your book. Well, Chicken Soup for the Teenage Soul sold 19 million copies, so I think it's going to be a grand slam home run, and it's not done yet. Google, which is arguably one of the most innovative companies of all time, constantly innovates. Did you know that Google rolls out a new capability or acquisition every month? That's right, every month. They look beyond the norm. They search out books, new tools, and they do whatever it takes. Google innovates at breakneck speeds, which puts them at the top of a very competitive industry. Wayne Gretzky is credited with saying, I go where the hockey puck is going. You need to know where the puck is. You need to go where the business is going and where it is trending. Have you ever researched something just because you like it? I highly suggest trying it if you haven't. It can be very enjoyable. Innovative people always expand their knowledge because the more they know makes them aware of how much more they didn't know. The more they know that they don't know means that there's still unlimited possibility for innovation and improvement. I'd say the leader of innovation these days is Steve Jobs, starting in a garage with Apple Computer, hiring somebody to run his company, getting fired by Scully, then coming back, making the company again. Then he saw that George Lucas wasn't doing too well with Pixar, so he went over to Pixar, bought it for $5 million, and now he is the biggest owner of Disney, which he merges into. And now he started iPhone, and that is the fastest growing phone in the world, and it is a changing innovation and improvement, and you can do the same. Socrates is credited as one of the wisest men on the earth, and the oracle told him so, because Socrates never claimed he knew anything, which made him a wise man. Socrates was in a constant stage of questioning, which in turn kept him in a constant state of learning. Forget everything that is currently accepted and begin to form your own opinions, do your own thoughts, be your own guinea pig. My great and inspiring intellectual teacher was Bucky Fuller. He said, each of us needs to be a human guinea pig and think for ourselves. Dr. Tom Peters wrote a book called The Circle of Innovation, and in it he provides a simple guide to strategic forgetfulness or organized forgetting. He feels, like I do, that you must be able to forget what was in order to move forward to what could be. Peter suggests a method of forgetting blockbusters. He points out that most products that spark new niches or industries end up being mostly used in ways that could not be imagined at the time of inception. But what if I fail? Failure and mistakes are the spice of life. Mistakes are not to be tolerated. Some people say, well, that's silly. Rather, mistakes are to be encouraged. How about that for company policy? That's what Peter says. Do you think the employees in that company are scared to try new and innovative things? No, they aren't. The employees in that company aren't afraid to try new things in order to observe what does or doesn't work. The only way to find out what works is try a lot of stuff that doesn't work first. I tried being bankrupt first, but I didn't like it, so I figured a way out to change my situation. I tried and kept testing new things until I found one that was going to work best for me. And I'm not alone, and you won't be either. What'll be good for you is that you learn what I'm about to share with you. It's okay to fail, as long as I learn. But only if you learn something. When you fail, not if, but when, the key is to learn something from it. Fear strangleholds many people in a death grip that keeps them from pursuing their dreams and doing what they desire. Keep experimenting. Practice until you get it right. After all, great innovators didn't stop until they find a way that works. They know that they must learn from their failures because failures build a foundation for greatest successes. The more failure you encounter, the greater triumph will be. So as long as you learn something in a process, you are moving forward. When I went bankrupt, I now say it was my best, worst experience. If I didn't do that, I couldn't have talked to several million people around the world at 5,000 talks. I couldn't have sold over 157 million books and have a goal of selling a billion books, which I believe I'm going to do. Those are innovations, and I'm innovating the marketing and the way that books are sold to create the future I want, just like I've been repetitively teaching you throughout. You must employ your failure. Consider it as an investment, and make sure that you get your return. It would be very wasteful to let all that valuable time and energy go to waste. According to Dr. Einstein, you would be insane. Einstein is credited with defining insanity as doing the same thing over and over again, but expecting new results. Let me do one other quote from Albert Einstein, and that is, he says you can never solve the problem at the level of the problem. You got to go above the problem and look down on the problem. Now, the way that I see that best is called prayer, meditation, contemplation, and reflection, where you do your deep breathing, you close your outer eyes and say, what is the solution to this? And the other guy that did that is Thomas Alva Edison. He used to lay down for catnaps and have a key in his hand, and he said, how do I do the electric light bulb? And a key would drop, and he kept coming up with idea after idea after idea until he figured out he could do tungsten in a vacuum, and that was the breakthrough. And a lot of people say that took 10,000 experiences or experiments or, oh my God, failures. Now, Kelly's book on innovation also says that every company needs to have someone who is a hurdler. Someone who is always testing the limits, the boundaries, and challenges absolutely every situation. If you're the only one person, always be looking over the current wall of limitation. You can go over it, under it, around it, through it. There's a gold mine on the other side. And the grass may actually be greener on the other side. As a deep investor in innovative energy, I tell you that there are a lot of alternative energies coming. Wind, tidal, geothermal, hydrokinetic, and it is going to be greener grass, and it's going to be less carbon rich, and we're going to have fresh air to breathe. Can you imagine that? Fresh air to breathe. Did you know that some of the most successful endeavors resulted from people attempting to solve a personal problem? The best ideas usually never geared at making loads of money. Although this isn't always the case, there are still a smart and select many that didn't seek their riches in their problem-solving idea. while the few others searched, many times in vain, for lost treasure in her ideas. This was due to a different perspective from those currently invested in the industry. If you are an innovator, failure's got to be incorporated into business plan because it's inevitable. As I said earlier, the more you fail, the greater your chance of success. However, this applies only if you avoid making the same mistake twice. Repeat after me. I will not make the same mistake twice. Continually search for new solutions. Always be testing, thinking, reflecting, praying, contemplating, working, and most importantly, improving on your ideas. I hope you have an idea journal and just keep writing down idea after idea, because what you can't do today, over time, your 18 billion bountiful, beautiful, totally underused brain cells will figure it out. You cannot ask a question without having a solution. Spiritual language always has been and always will be, ask and you shall receive. Who are you asking? You're asking spirit, universal intelligence in you, and it will outpicture as your answer. Because when you adopt an improving mindset, innovation will become your money set, and it'll come naturally with ever greater effectiveness and efficiency. You know, sometimes you'll stumble across your solution by accident. The best example may be the George Foreman grill. When it was first introduced by Salton, the barbecue, sold on an infomercial, had lackluster sales. Then in a candid, informal moment, George Foreman grabbed a burger off the grill and took a hungry bite, seemingly not conscious of the camera. That candid camera moment has appeared now in every infomercial being aired, and the last number I received states that he has sold 170 million George Foreman grills. Infomercials have to be transparent, authentic, compelling, inviting, and instantly money-generating. Innovation shows up everywhere. Yes, even in infomercials. And I've got several out that are working, so I know this game intimately well. Infomercials were an innovation in and of themselves. TV, when I was a kid, used to stop at 11 o'clock, at which point the American flag would proudly wave across three channels, ABC, NBC, and CBS. If you're old enough, you're smiling and chortling and remembering this, you know, it'd wake you up if you're asleep on the floor or in your sofa or your lazy boy, and that flag would say, whoops, time to go to bed, Bubba. Someone decided that extra TV time was valuable, and thus the creation of infomercials. Information commercials is what that means. Someone saw the money-generating potential of extra unused TV time. It did something with it. That something now generates billions and billions of dollars and is now a staple on TV. Infomercials come in a couple different forms. They come in shorts, 2 minutes, 90 seconds, 60 seconds, and 30 seconds, and longs, 28 minutes and 30 seconds, and they are fun to do and are amazing at the outreach because a lot of insomniacs obviously stay up late at night and watch it. I want to tell you about a friend of mine. Two friends of mine, actually. I know this story intimately at a lot of different levels, but let me just hit you at one level about innovation. Bud Paxton, years ago, less than two decades ago, owns a radio station down in Florida. He goes out to get paid by a client who owns a hardware store, and the client said, look, I got no money to pay you, and your ad didn't sell. Well, he said, you got to give me something. He says, well, I got nothing to give you except these can openers that play a song when you open a can. Paxton took cases of them back to his office, walks into the newscaster, my other close friend, Bob Sercosta, and says, Bob, I want you to sell these can openers. He said, no, I'm not a salesman, I'm a newscaster. He says, well, let me explain it to you simple. If you want to get paid today, you will sell these. Well, it was amazing that Bob Sercosta had never tried to sell anything on the radio before, immediately offered the singing can openers and sold 126, and people came driving down to the railroad station. Well, Bud Paxton and Bob would tell you that this is the opening of a thing called infomercials. Bud Paxton went on to create a thing called Home Shopping Network, which he sold for billions of dollars, at which time he invested in Chicken Soup for the Soul TV. Now, what I want you to understand is that little openings make big things happen. And there's two kinds of logic. Deductive, where you start with a D and you go from general to specific. And inductive, you start with a little dot over the I and go from the little to the big. This shows both of those. And I've been around since infomercials started and fascinated at how fast it grows. Once you get a foothold and once you plant that seed in the ground, it attracts all the water, all the nutrient, all the sunshine, and photosynthesis is started. The same with innovation. If your innovation is successful, it will create a ripple effect, often resulting in the creation of new markets that it fits into. People didn't know short stories would sell in a Chicken Soup for the Soul format because no one else had ever adapted our method. But did they sell? You betcha. And they're still selling. And in nonfiction, I'm the world's best-selling author, according to Guinness Book of Records, and we're the biggest licensor. We are selling hundreds of millions of dollars worth of Chicken Soup for the Soul dog food a year, and now we are doing organic baby food. Because of that innovation, I've started Hansen House Press, and we are going to sell 1 billion books. This is so exciting to me. I want you to understand, I don't care how little you are, how invisible you are, how educated or uneducated you are, whether you're male, female, young, or old, all I want you to do is buy into the fact that you are an innovator. I've asked you again and again to do these affirmations. You got to keep repeating to yourself, I am an innovator, and hit yourself in the chest. Brand this into your brain, etch it in the fabric of your being. Make it part of the essence of who you are. It doesn't matter what you haven't been, haven't done, haven't thought, haven't said. It matters where are you now and where are you going to go. And you're going to go to be an innovator. My intention is that this is the precursor of your innovation. Anyone who's ever had any form of success, whether great or small, had a strong intention to change and rectify something. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. desired to rectify inequality. The doctor proved the greater the intention, the greater the innovation. He did it because Rosa Parks was on a bus and she was black. And they put an orange little dot on and said, everybody black, sit behind her. They moved the dot and said, you move. She said, look, I only make $10 a month and I'm just a little seamstress, but I'm not moving. You can arrest me. They arrested her, and that started Martin Luther King's dream. He says, I have a dream. And that dream opened up equality for blacks and the civil rights movement and so many wonderful freedoms. Because as long as anybody lacks freedom, all of us lack some level of freedom. So the question again is, what is your intention? This is different from a goal. This is different from how. This is the end result. And that's where I say start. Start at the end. We started it saying we're going to be a mega best-selling book series. What is it that you must accomplish through your innovation? Do you have intentions to engineer the fastest car in the world or a battery-driven car? Why? What? How? All the words that'll get your mind thinking positively rather than negatively. Spend all your focus on how it can be done and never on how it can't be done. That's what innovators do. To be the best, to prove someone wrong, to change your world. Whatever the reason, be sure that it is sincere and uplifting and it's your reason. You don't need somebody else's reason. What's your reason? When the innovation you create have a positive impact on the world will improve on a massive scale. We can all agree that this world could use a little improving. Take the time to find your why, and you will undoubtedly find your how. Allow yourself to become innovative. Allow yourself to fail. Allow yourself to live at levels you never thought you could live. You may ask, as you've listened to this, how important is innovation? Well, let me just tell you that innovation has gotten us out of every depression, and my read of it is that it takes three innovations. In America, the Depression, 1898 to 1906, we got out with three little things. Two guys are walking down the street talking to each other and saying, oh my God, we're out of whale oil and America's going to shut off the lights. One was Henry Morrison Flagler, who started a company called Standard Oil. His walking partner, you know his name, is John D. Rockefeller. And they went to Titusville and they did what was called break oil. Today we call it refine oil. That allowed another guy to innovate a car called Henry Ford, who we talked about earlier. And in 1906, he went from zero to 14 million cars in 1 year. Now, when he did that, suddenly there was a need for mechanics, there's a need for roads, there's a need for driver's license. There's all kinds of needs that come out of one great innovation. So you got oil being broken into gas, you suddenly have automobiles, and then you got two little brothers, a dream team, and we're going to teach such things if you keep listening. But you get a dream team of Orville and Wilbur fly 14 feet at Kitty Hawk, and that gave America hope. Now fast forward to the Depression of 29 to 39, and you got three innovations that are going to change the world. You have the jet plane, you've got television, and you've got the computer. And they got us out of the economic doo-doo, because the only way out is either war or innovation. I'm saying the three innovations that are going to get us out right now, in my mind, are alternative energy, which we've talked about, and I'm one of the leading proponents. I'm as green as it gets. I'm helping to make red China green China with alternative energy and all the companies we're doing with natural power concepts, headquartered in Oahu, Hawaii, run by the top surrealist artist in the world, the Leonardo da Vinci of our time, who is John Petrie, who we've got 101 patents right now that are going to change the world, and we've got the biggest partners in the world, like Oshkosh, the biggest maker of fire engines, and we've got British Columbia Hydropower starting to use our stuff. So it is exquisitely exciting, and I think my teacher, Bucky Fuller, said we're going to go from dollarability and gold standard to EU energy standard. Next thing I think is going to change the world is the telephone. And the telephone now has gone to what's called G3 and G4, Generation 4 and Generation 3. And that allows books to be printed. It allows 3D animation. I've seen the new phone. It's called Gitfugu. And it's going to change the world, because right now there are 4 billion telephones. There's only 1,200,000,000 computers. And I think the phone is one of the new forms of computing. So we've said we got alternative energy. We've got the telephone. The third thing that's going to change it is you, my dear friend. You, I hope, come up with the innovation that's going to change the world. I hope you'll write me. I hope you'll tell me about your innovation, because I want to stay at the forefront, because in the world, you're either leading edge, cutting edge, dull edge, or trailing edge. Most people have never decided what edge they are. I'm asking you, as a friend of mine, now that you've listened to me, be the innovator. Now repeat after me. I will no longer be bound by the restraints of the past. I'll forget all those things that are restrictive of my movement. The next time I think something can't be done because it doesn't work with the old model, I'll forget the old model. I'll begin to look at things in a new, unique point of view. I will make decisions based on what I know to be true. I'll never again let someone else's doubt get in the way of my intention to change the world. I will make the new model. I will be an innovator. The last and most important homework assignment is to be that innovator. I'm going to repeat it again. You be the innovator. I give you permission. I give you acceptance. I hope you'll listen to this again and again. Be excited and titillated at the fiber of your being to be the innovator. Decide that you can do it. Whether it be a weekly, bi-weekly, monthly, or whatever works for you, decide that the law of attraction says that you have to have your intention in writing. Write it down on a daily basis, your new idea, your new innovation. Write down one no matter what. Tell yourself before you go to sleep, program your mind that you're going to wake up, and your conscious and subconscious are going to see, observe, discover, and outpicture new innovations that are money-making. You're going to turn your thinking into creative money-making by writing down your journal of ideas. You'll be amazed at the result that your writing of ideas makes them so. You'll attract automatically and axiomatically the right people. It'll be as if by magic all those right people show up and help you realize your dreams and desires. They'll help you figure it out. I like to keep my ideas within sight. It's visual cues to focus my day. They're usually posted on my bathroom mirror so I can start my entire day knowing what I'm working towards and accomplishing. Put your goals within your sight. When you've finished all your immediate goals, frame them with sight to remind you continually that you're traveling down a path of innovation to achieve your utmost rip-roaring wealth, because the most unselfish thing you can do is become vastly wealthy. In fact, the revelation of your dreams and desires has started today, right now. go forth, be innovative, and conquer the world. Peace and blessings, my friends. I see you as a magnificent, magnanimous, philanthropic, extraordinary innovator.
You've been learning from Mark Victor Hansen, America's Ambassador of Possibility. See Mark's appearance schedule and get access to a powerful range of free audio and video downloads. Visit www.markvictorhansen.com. To bring Mark's 30 years of wealth creating experience to your stage or boardroom, call toll-free 800-433-2314. That's 800-433-2314. On behalf of Mark Victor Hansen and Made for Success, we wish you rip-roaring wealth.